Hello! Yes, welcome. This is the book that got me really started, I suppose, in turning. Often recommended to people starting out, even in this age of YouTube and online stuff galore. There's something very satisfying, I think, about having a book, a manual. And going to do some stuff from it, inspired by it. Just a few little occasional videos on using the tools alongside my more outlandish efforts of colouring and texturing and generally destroying round and brown. Mwahaha. Right, let's get on with it. So this is my Spindle roughing gouge. It's a record power tool. I bought it secondhand when I bought my first lathe. That was 13 years ago, and I guess the guy before me had had it for at least 10 years or so. It probably indicates how little spindle turning I do. But this is the Spindle roughing gouge, to give it its full name. You'll notice it's got a tang that goes into the handle, and then the bar, I suppose, is rolled round to give this curved cutting tool. That is only for spindles, only for cutting when the grain is running along the line of the axis of the headstock and the tailstock. This is never to be used for faceplate work. The grinding of this tool is probably one of the easiest and simplest to do. Just ground square across against a grinder or on a pro edge or whatever else device you might use for sharpening. And my one is ground at about 45 degrees. It's square across, as I said, no cutting back of the corners, because then you can use this to get a nice crisp edge up against a shoulder. Now, it will cut if you put it straight onto the wood, but it's quite a bit of an effort. It will cut more easily if you just angle it slightly and you get a little spiralling cut. And maybe we'll be able to show that a little better once I've got it a bit round. But there you are, there's a little spiralling cut rather than this great big wedge of wood that comes out. So in terms of preparing the tool, you obviously have your wood spinning first. You don't just stick your gouge in, because that would be foolhardy, and get a nice big bang. You're going to start off by, let me come out a little further, by putting it on the tool rest, making sure that it's not spinning, that we're not catching the wood, and then you lift the handle up. Now, if you just lift the handle up straight away, that means that you're going to get the heaviest of those cuts going in. So it's better to have it at a slight angle, and then you will get those slicing cuts that I was talking about. So you get a little spiral going in the wood, much easier to cut. You can just, for your first cut, put the tool down on the anchor it onto the tool rest, engage the bevel, and then cut. Now, you're going to want to move the tool along, but you do not move the tool like this. You don't move your arms, you move your body. So once you've got the cut, shift your weight. Notice my arms are staying still, so I'm just shifting the weight from one foot to the next. Now, a few things to notice about this piece of wood. If we come back onto the overhead, I've still got some bark on. That is likely to chip off and go flying off. So make sure that you have got a full face shield on. Direction of cut. I'm going to start on this end first, but I'm not going to start right at the end. I'm going to work towards the end with a short distance, moving the tool further back for subsequent cuts, and making a cylinder. So let's get some power on and a face shield on, and then we'll do that first cut. Always spin the work by hand to make sure it's going to miss the tool rest. And the tool rest is just below centre. So I'm going to start it up. Fairly lowish speed.
going a few hundred. So onto the tool rest and just lift the handle slowly. I'll come and do that again on this shot. So I'm lifting the handle slowly, just beginning to bite, and then just moving across. Come back, do the same. Drop your handle, but keep the tool on the tool rest. Come back, lift the handle. And move along. Lift the handle. And move along. Come back a bit further. Engage the cup. Lift the handle and move along.
So that movement is very simple, very straightforward, cutting reasonably nicely. This is a piece of ash, even at a low speed, because it's about the technique. So we just go over that again. If I come onto the overhead, it's having the tool, and I'll come back even wider. Having the tool at about 25 degrees, it's slightly rolled over as well. So put it onto the tool rest, angle it, and then drop the handle until the cut is engaged. And there, hopefully you can see that is slicing very nicely across there. It's cutting it much more easily than if I were doing this. Yes, it cuts, but it's much harder, much more effort. Right, so let's carry on doing that movement. Onto the tool rest first, lift the handle and then shift your weight over onto your right leg.
So it's on the bevel, it's on the tool rest. It's not cutting yet. Lift the back hand. Lift your back hand up and move along. So when you get to the end, the reason for not lifting it up is you've suddenly lost all your sort of reference points. And if I come back and put it on the tool rest now, I might hit the wood. So always put it on, keep it on the tool rest really, but put it on well away from the wood and then advance slowly. Lift the handle. And slide along.
And you keep going till you've got a cylinder. Don't be tempted to come onto the wood from out here because you've got nothing for the bevel to hit first. So it's a bit of sort of guessing. You might be able to sense that as you develop your turning skills. But for now, make sure that you're always working towards an end. Now, down here for the tool rest, I've got a big gap here. I can get my hand down there. That's a bit of a dangerous gap to have. I can't go any closer though because I haven't cut this side off. So I'm going to bring this side down now to a similar depth of cut so that I can then bring the tool rest back in.
So onto the tool rest, knock in. Bark off, I think. Move along, slide back, engage the cut, move it back, engage the cut, lift the handle, you can do it in little nibbles if you prefer. See, I'm only moving a short distance this time. And then join those pinks up. And now I'm going to stop. I've got a big gap here. Move the tool rest in. Always keep the tool rest as close to the work as possible.
So there's now no danger of my fingers getting caught in that gap.
Lift the back handle. Shift your weight. Now it's mostly round. I can pull the tool back, feeling where the wood is, keeping the back of it hitting there.
Now, one other thing, what you may notice is that my hand, the left hand, is against the tool rest, and that's giving a kind of guide and keeping a, sort of setting it as a depth stop, depth of cut. If I had my hand not on the guide, I haven't got the same kind of control. Now, that's fine to do in spindle turning like this, because you're pretty much keeping the movement the same, but when you shaping a bowl, you might find the tool rest occasionally gets a little bit in the way. So, gap there, I can get a finger down it. Let's come and finish off this side.
So, onto the tool rest, it's not cutting, lift the handle, there's the cut, shift your weight. And you can see we're getting much longer shavings coming off now that it's almost round, compared to the very short ones that were coming off when I was putting the tool on like this. So it's going all the way round now.
So you can see that perhaps a bit better. If I put it onto an angle, it cuts, the cut is much easier. Much less effort, much less strain than if you had it at 90 degrees. It takes a bigger shaving, but it's a bit more effort to get that shaving off. We're still not quite round, as you can see here. So, tool rest in. And let's work towards the ends. Put the speed up a bit now.
Exactly the same process.
Just about there, a little tiny flat left, a little bit of the bark left there. So another couple of passes and this will be nice and true and round. So there we have it, a brief intro to the spindle roughing gouge, often just referred to as the roughing gouge, but please don't forget that important part of its name, spindle roughing gouge. It's for spindle work only, not for bowls. Not for any cross grain, not really for any branch wood that may have branches coming out from the side as either. It's a bit too hard. The weak point of this tool is that tang. If you are buying a second hand roughing gouge and this angle is not the same as the angle here, but this is bent up or bent down, it's been weakened at this point, and I, for one, wouldn't buy a second-hand spindle roughing gouge with that feature. So, one last fast pass through to get a nice clean surface.
Going to find where my feet, that's where I'm going to want to stop. Come back. Engage the cut. Move smoothly. transfer the weight slowly. Remember to keep breathing during your cut. Don't hold your breath. You want to try to get a nice, smooth, fluid movement. And maybe
the final thing to say is about the grip. You're not holding it like it's trying to escape from you. You're holding it lightly in your hands so that you've got flexibility, you've got movement. It's not wobbling around, but you're not gripping it so tight that you've got bare white knuckles. Now let's have a look at that. So that's much nicer, cleaner, smoother all the way along. If you want to get critical of yourself, you can start putting a straight edge along it and seeing where have you got gaps, and see I'm a little bit narrower this end than up this end. But that's maybe half a millimeter or so, that end. But that's our introduction to the spindle roughing gouge done. If you've got any comments or any questions, leave them below. And thanks for watching.